tree is not on purpose, don't think, oh man, Pastor forgot to light the tree. The tree is not on purpose because we're going to hang ornaments after. And then always at the end of hanging ornaments, we will sing a hymn together and light the tree during the singing. So it's not on for a reason. There is a method to my madness sometimes. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn 331, The Advent of Our King. I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the said and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. revive us again that your people may rejoice in you.
Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his saints, but let them not turn back to folly.
Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice.
Thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me.
Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in the darkness, and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendation from God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. We rise to the reading of the Gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 11th chapter.
Thank you.
lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me. Do you think faith and reason are compatible? Or does our faith sometimes believe in what is unreasonable? Is it reasonable to believe that God became a man? How can this be? It appears to be impossible. God is infinite, man not so much. Didn't the great Greek philosopher Aristotle, who was a very reasonable man, demonstrate that the finite is not capable of the infinite? God can't become a baby. Christmas, then, must be a myth. Who can believe that the little baby lying in the manger is the Lord Almighty? But he is. We know he is the Almighty God. He has told us so in his holy word. We know that Jesus is God Almighty because he did what only God could do. Jesus demonstrated his true deity again and again. He changed water into wine. That revealed his eternal glory, the glory of the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. Who can give sight to a man born blind? Jesus did. When he enabled the lame to walk, there were witnesses present who knew the lame man was really and truly lame, and that Jesus really did heal him. When Jesus gave the deaf their hearing, it was publicly witnessed and verified. Today, so-called faith healers heal diseases whose symptoms cannot be seen. You have to take their word for it. But Jesus did miracles that could be and word empirically, that is, scientifically verified. He was no common. He raised from the dead. When Elijah raised up the dead son of a widow, he called on God to bring the child back to life. We actually talked about that in the sermon this fall. When Jesus raised up the dead son of a widow, he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." I say to you, Jesus said. He appealed to his own authority and his own power to do what is impossible for men to do. The Old Testament prophets did many miracles, and yet Jesus did three times as many as all of them combined, as recorded in the Holy Scripture. The Old Testament prophets did miracles to prove their word was in fact God's word. Moses put Pharaoh's magicians to shame. On Mount Carmel, Elijah did the same to the prophets of Baal. In Old Testament times, God did miracles through his prophets. And the prophets appealed to the divine power outside of themselves. But Jesus did miracles as the incarnate Son of God. He made it clear that the miracles he was doing was done by his own divine authority. He was the only begotten of the Father in eternity. He became a human being. He demonstrated his true deity in and through his humanity, just as the prophets said he would. We read in the book of the prophet Isaiah that the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing, "The Lord has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor." Christ and his Christians faced fierce enemies in the early church. Many sought to discredit Jesus. Some of the anti-Christian propaganda in those early years accused Jesus of black magic or even appealing to the power of the devil. But no one in the early church, even the opponents of Christ, argued that Jesus didn't do the miracles recorded in the Gospels. There were too many witnesses that said he did. The miracles of Jesus were visibly verified, and Jesus points to them when John questions him. Jesus says to John's disciples, "Go and tell John the things which you hear and see." These miracles not only had a physical significance, but also a spiritual significance. He gave the blind their sight to teach that he was the light of the world, who provides spiritual enlightenment to those blinded by their sins. He gave the deaf their hearing, enabled the lame to walk, to teach everyone who listened to his voice and followed him that they would have eternal life. He cleansed the lepers to teach that raised the dead to teach that he is the resurrection and the life. Some deny Christ's miracles. Since he did what is impossible for men to do, they deny that he did it. Since they never experienced it, they can conclude that it cannot happen. And they think they're being reasonable. But it's not reasonable to deny what hundreds of witnesses saw. Some people, simply by principle, reject the supernatural. Many of these are atheists. They want to explain everything in this world in purely material ways. There is no supernatural reality, they say. It's unreasonable. They are offended by Jesus, because he proves them wrong. But those who are the most deeply offended by Jesus are oftentimes the religious people who do believe in who do believe in heaven and hell, who sincerely think that they honor our Lord. Take the devoted Muslim, Mason, or Mormon, who dutifully does what he thinks will gain him eternal life. Many of these admire Jesus. Many of these try to follow his example. But they refuse to see themselves as spiritually poor. And because of that, they cannot tolerate the gospel. Oh, sure, they'll tolerate some perversion of Christianity that's not actually Christian at all. But when they hear that they are poor, that they are needy, that they are sinners, when they hear that they can do nothing to obtain the favor and goodwill of God, and that for all of their efforts, they still deserve to be cast out from God's face and damned to hell, well, many take great offense at that. Those most offended by Jesus don't really know what it is about Jesus that offends him. A pastor friend of mine told me about a wedding he had agreed to do for a young lady in his congregation. This young lady was marrying a Roman Catholic young man. And the young lady's parents, remember the young lady is one of his parishioners, asked my friend, who's a pastor, to invite the Catholic priest to come say a few words at the wedding. And my friend said he could do so at the reception, but not in the midst of the wedding service. They got mad, the parents. They wanted it to be done in the church. My pastor friend explained that this would not be possible, and when they asked why, he explained that the Roman Catholic priest taught a different gospel than what the Lutheran pastor taught. The Roman Catholic priest taught that a person's good deeds help get them to heaven. And my friend said that that is contrary to the gospel. The true gospel teaches us that it is Christ's good deeds that get us. Salvation is by faith alone in Christ, and that our good works contribute nothing to our salvation. The bride's mother became very angry with my friend, and she proceeded to attack the very gospel that he had preached to this woman and her family for years. She claimed that his gospel permitted sinners to continue in their sin. She thought that if our good deeds don't contribute to our salvation, then we have no reason to thought she was giving my pastor friend quite the education. Interestingly, she was a lifelong Lutheran, and yet still believed she was working her way to heaven. She wasn't angry because my friend wouldn't let a Catholic priest participate in the church service. She was angry at the gospel that my friend preached. And that's the gospel that Jesus taught. Jesus said, "The poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me." Many people who believe that they love Jesus can't stand the gospel that he preaches. They take offense to it. They are offended because they refuse to see themselves as poor. There's a popular preacher by the name of Joyce Meyer. Some of you may have even read Joyce's books. Joyce was raised in a congregation of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. And yet, as she got older, she rejected the gospel that we preach. Here's a quote from Joyce Meyer. "All I ever was taught was to say, I, a poor, miserable sinner." Ironic, because she also said that this morning. She says, "I am not poor, I am not miserable, and I am not a sinner. That is a lie from the pit of hell. That is what I were, and if I still was, then Jesus died in vain. I am going to tell you something, folks. I didn't stop sinning." Listen to those words. "I didn't stop sinning until I finally got through my thick head. I wasn't a sinner anymore. And the religious world thinks that is heresy, and they want to hang me for it. But the Bible says that I am righteous, and I can be righteous and a sinner at the same time. Thus says Joyce Meyer. Note well what offended this woman. She was offended that she was called a poor, miserable sinner. She claims that because she is righteous, she is no longer a sinner. That argument has been used in the church for quite a long time. Many in the church agree with Joyce Meyer that you can't be righteous and a sinner at the same time, which Jesus says, blessed is he who is not offended because of me. My friends, you and I are poor. We are miserable, and we are sinners. And yet Jesus looks at us and says, blessed are the poor. He enriches the poor with the very kingdom of God. You are rich because of him. God tells you that you are righteous in his gospel. The gospel that Jesus preaches to the poor tells you that you are rich. You are righteous, you are heaven-bound, and that God's favor shines on you. That is what the gospel teaches us. Yet as we examine our lives under the harsh glare of God's perfect law, what do we see? We see that we are indeed poor in this sense. Yet God says that we are righteous. That means this righteousness cannot have anything to do with what you and I are actually doing. It is based on the obedience and suffering of Jesus. That righteousness is perfect, and that means that we are perfectly righteous. But this is not an excuse to sin. This is not a claim that we are no longer poor, miserable sinners. The gospel tells us that God honors truth. As surely as Jesus obeyed, we are righteous. As surely as Jesus suffered, our sins are forgiven. This won't become true when we stop sinning. It's true now. Examine yourself this morning, friends. Be honest. Examine your heart, your words, your deeds. Examine yourself in the light of God's holy law. Have you loved anyone or anything this last week more than God? Have you honored God in everything that you said and done? Have you taken every opportunity God has given you to hear his word, to take it in? Have you honored those in the authority over you? Have you helped your neighbor in his bodily needs? Have you led a sexually pure and decent life? Have you taken what didn't belong to you? Have you told lies and repeated unkind stories about your neighbor? Have you been content with everything God has given you instead of lusting for more? I don't know about you, but when I look at those questions, I realize I failed in each and every one of those questions. We see what we have done. We see what we are, and you are here because you repent of it. And after we repent, we rejoice. In our introit for today, we said these words, rejoice in the Lord always. The Lord is at hand. The contradiction between what God says in the gospel and what you feel in your body will one day disappear. Our flesh is offended by the gospel. We still have a desire to sin, and let's face it, oftentimes we obey that. The gospel tells us, though, that we are righteous and rich. And what we witness with our eyes is sin and poverty. But rejoice, Christian. Don't be offended by Jesus and his gospel. The gospel truth is that everything God tells you in the gospel today, that you are forgiven, righteous, holy, that you are headed for glory and an heir to eternal life, God will confirm your very eyes when Jesus returns. You are poor, and Christ proclaims his gospel to you, and that makes you rich. Don't be offended because you can't prove it. He who guarantees it is God in the flesh himself, and he proves it. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We sing together our offering. people and restore the fortunes of your church by the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ. Fill us with rejoicing at all times and give reasonableness to our words and deeds, that all may recognize our Christian confidence in your advent. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Almighty God, through your Son, you bring to light the things hidden in darkness and disclose the purposes of the heart. Give your church faithful stewards of your true mysteries, servants of Christ who are trustworthy to proclaim you alone as Lord and Judge. Tend your flock by your word and spirit, that your lambs may be gathered into your arms and gently led to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, be the source of strength and comfort in every home. Bless the children of our families, that every darkness would be lightened by your Son's gracious visitation. Preserve them from dangers to body and soul. Guide them by your word in wise paths, and keep them firm in the faith till life's end. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all comforts, your word alone endures forever. The nations of the world come and go before you. Even kings and rulers are like grass before your breath. Preserve us from placing our trust in princes and mortal men. Give us rulers who will rule after your good pleasure, keeping order and protecting life, that we may live peaceably in godly quietness and honesty. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give ear, O Shepherd of Israel, to our prayers, especially for Gerald, Cheryl, Matthew, Sherry, Barb, Sue, Cameron, Roland, Dwayne, Carol, Nancy, Dale, Michelle, Tony, Tom, Alicia, Nathan, Cindy, Kayla, Tanner, Julia, Jean, Harry, Jerry, Betty, Dee, Jan, Joan, Amy, and Kylie, Don, Doris, and those that we name before you in our hearts now. Give healing, courage, and perseverance to all who cry to you, that they may find comfort in your enduring word and a certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life with Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Fount of all blessings, be with those this week who have cause to celebrate. With Jim and Lisa as they celebrate their birthdays. With Dawn and Ellie as they celebrate their baptismal birthdays. And with Trisha and I as we celebrate our anniversary. Keep all your children in your tender love throughout this world and in the next. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed, O Lord, is everyone who is not offended by your Christ. Give us faith to believe your blessed testament, see your holy supper for the forgiveness of our sins, and confess your truth with honest hearts in communion with one another at the altar this day. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all. Trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Continue with the service of the sacrament, I invite you to repent.
Thank you.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thank you.
Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Normal for us to take a kind of clothing donation. I know, I worked really hard for you all. Jenny came to me talking about a foundation that's here in West Dallas called the Wish Foundation. The Wish Foundation is a group that supports abused and battered women. And this year, the West Dallas Police Department has partnered with them to do a type of clothing drive. Normally, we would try to do something where we were bringing in stuff, but with COVID, used things, son, stand right here and stop jumping. Used clothing would be fine, but this year with COVID and everything, no one's taking that stuff. So what Jenny has done is she's went through and looked at what she thinks we can support. She went through with her own time and got one of our drive-in packages to help kickstart this for us. And so you'll notice on the back table as you go out, there are bags. Can you hold that up, Judy? Judy's got one of them right here. Some of you have the Friday shirts that get handed out with these things. What Jenny has done is she's bagged all of those individually by size, put some candies and some information in there, and then take one of those and give a free will offering, and we'll use that collection to help fund the rest of the buying of its socks and just all kinds of stuff that these ladies need when they leave bad situations. Many of them have nothing. And so this would be a way for us to continue our support of those in our community that need things without doing a clothing drive like we normally do. Hopefully by next year we'll be able to resume that stuff. We're going to run that for a couple of weeks, so don't feel bad if you wanted to put the dollars that you have. If you only brought enough dollars for the ornament stuff, we'll do that next week also for the Wish Foundation. So a couple of weeks in a row at least, so that we can get that stuff and maybe brighten those ladies' day a little bit. And so they know it's not under either of our names, it's under the church's name, so they will see that it is Trinity Lutheran Church that is supporting them. And maybe that may be the seed necessary to grow the gospel and faith in the hearts of some of these ladies and know that the church actually does love them and care about them and is here for them. So if you have any more questions about that, either ask me after service or read the information. We've got a little bit of information out there that tells about what the Wish Foundation is and what they do. Oh, yeah, Jenny put candies on the table if you'd like to snitch some of the candies, too. Also, for our hanging of the ornaments, we do have cookies and things made, some nice little baked goods in the Bible study room, along with coffee. So feel free to help yourself. And after I change, then we'll get started with the ornament hang. Last announcement I think I have is on your calendars, you'll notice that Christmas morning is at 8:30 instead of 8. I'm doing that purely out of selfishness. I don't have to be at Oklahoma Avenue until 10, and there's no Bible study Christmas morning. So to keep me from having to sit around for an hour while my kids are nagging at me to go home and open presents, it's really easy if I can just leave one place, go straight to the other, and start a service. So that's really just for me. So sorry if that confuses anybody. I didn't mean to. I selfishly thought of myself when I signed the time. And so, if you have any questions about the calendar or anything, please let me know. Are there any announcements that I have forgotten about? Yes, Mark.
I just want to thank all those who helped trustees.
Oh, yes, geez, my goodness.
Children and adults.
Yeah, we had a good group yesterday, both with kids and adults. My kids, Andrea's kids, came over and they checked all of the lights for us. And it was wonderful to have all of the hands, big and small, to make our church beautiful for Christmas. I love walking into the sanctuary and smelling the vine. And so what a wonderful thing for us, wonderful blessing. Thank you, Mark, for reminding me that. I should have thought of that. Any other announcements that I have neglected? All right.